Welcome to Kaiser Watch with John Kaiser. I'm your host, Jim Goddard.
John, welcome back to Kaiser Watch.
Jim, happy to be back on the show.
John, Kanalaska Uranium reported results for what you called the discovery hole at its West MacArthur project. Did it meet expectations?
When the company put out the announcement of the visuals, they described that there was a 6-meter interval within the basement between 800 and 900 meters beneath the unconformity, and they had registered clicks up to 39,000, and they were hoping to get, you know, a couple percent of U308 for those 6 meters. In fact, when they finally got the geochemical assays this week, they had 9 meters of 2.4%, and the 6-meter interval actually ran 3.5%. Now, what does that mean? Well, 2.4% at $47 uranium, that's $2,500 rock. And a 3.5%, it jumps to $3,600. So the stock, which had started to lag as the market wondered when are these assays coming, has started to perk up again and managed to claw its way back above 50 cents. Now, this hole is very important because it's a conductor that sort of streaks off from the C10 group that hosts the Fox Lake system and the 42 zone. That's on their side of the border, which is what attracted a Cameco as a partner. They've been diluted down to about 20% at this stage. And the company is very excited about the geological context. They've got 2 rigs on there now. Now, the depth of the interval between 800 and 900 meters, that's quite deep. The second rig has now drilled a pilot hole, and they're starting to wedge. But it turns out that hitting this hole in the first place was an absolute stroke of luck, because these high-grade systems within the basement are very complex, and they are now trying to wedge with a rig, 2 rigs that are not the right type for it. They would like to do directional rig drilling, which allows them to very precisely guide the core head towards the zone and start stepping it out so they can start delineating it. At the moment, because of the way the drills deviate in that, they're busy putting together the structural framework for this system. And if we're lucky, we'll get some more intervals as they start to sort it out. These intervals, by the way, they cannot yet say that they have, that it's true width yet. It's probably less than true width. They still think it dips to the southeast. They need several pierce points within the zone so that they can start to understand, okay, now this is where we're going. But the importance of this is the geological context. This is a very strong conductor related to the Collins Bay fault system that holds Eagle Point and Rabbit Lake. The structural complexity that they're seeing within intense hydrothermal alteration, this is what you want to see in order to be very optimistic that a MacArthur River style deposit, and that's, you know, 16% uranium, couple million tons, it's at the unconformity but also reaches into the basement. They have not yet found or encountered where the vein system in the basement intersects with the sandstone, the unconformity. That's where you might expect the zone to blossom even larger. That's what the market's hoping for, is that they get lucky with this fall drilling that they're doing now, that they can spear into the portion of the system that's at the unconformity. But for now, we have to just satisfy ourselves that they've got 2 rigs going, they've got 2 pilot holes from which they are wedging, and they're slowly stitching together the geological framework, and hopefully we will get additional assays in the next few weeks. The company will be at the Metals Investor Forum in Vancouver on September 9th to 10th and as part of my session, and it is an emerging discovery that I think will attract a lot of attention, because this has the potential to be another West MacArthur system. It is deep, but that depth doesn't really matter to the big operators like Cameco who are looking for more high-grade uranium ore in the Athabasca Basin.
This year's copper price retreat has not helped P2 Gold, which is working to demonstrate the feasibility of its Gabs copper gold project in Nevada. How are things going for its BAM gold exploration play in the Golden Triangle?
Well, P2 Gold has released the first batch of 45 holes they've so far completed at the BAM project. They are targeted on the Monarch Zone. They are relatively shallow holes. They are getting decent gold intervals. What hasn't yet happened is the drilling of the deeper holes designed to test what they hypothesized to be a feeder structure that fed this system. They were planning to do a Z10 survey with whose geophysics they were going to combine with several other geophysical data sets that they had, and they got everything geared up at the end of June, but because of weather delays, and this of course is a plague in the Golden Triangle, even during the summer, they did not get this survey done until early August, and they are still crunching the data to figure out where the target is for which they can drill some deeper holes to see where all this mineralization, this epithermal system is coming from. So the results so far indicate, yes, the Monarch Zone is evolving as an open pittable, 1 to 2 gram per ton system. We have to wait to see if the target comes into view and that they have time to drill. They'll be able to drill into October. So this is the potential for kind of a blue sky discovery that changes everybody's attention or takes the attention away from the Gabs copper gold project in Nevada. They are working on a preliminary economic assessment. They plan to have this out early in the fourth quarter, maybe even earlier. And the question, of course, is with copper declining, this has not been very helpful. Because when I did a simplified outcome visualization earlier this year, at 450, it was kind of marginal development play. And of course, an important factor for any economic study is what is the base case price that you are going to use. Now, with copper bumbling around 350 a pound, this is now lower than the 3-year average. And the rule is if the 3-year trailing average is less than the spot price, then you use that. But if suddenly the spot price has been crunched by some, temporary economic factors, and it's lower than the trailing average, well, then you're not supposed to use the trailing average. So they have discussed this and apparently are going to use a consensus number generated by a variety of analysts, which will be somewhere between the 3-year trailing average and the current spot price when they do put out these results. So the Gabs project's on track. They expect to have a much better outcome than envisioned in my little outcome visualization, because they see this first as a heap leach, open pittable system which does not have high capex. The upper part of the system is richer in gold than in copper, so they plan to get cash flow from the gold component, which they'll be able to reinvest a number of years down the road to build the mill that's needed to process the sulfides, which are richer in copper. So it'll be really interesting to see how they have optimized the ore schedule and also the capex spending structure so that we can see that even if the price ends up being, copper price ends up being $3.50 to $4 in there, does it clear all the hurdles of minimum 15% IRR and a capex an after-tax NPV that matches or exceeds the capex for the project.
How is Lithium Mania 2.0 doing in the current resource sector bear market?
Well, most metal prices have fallen off in the last quarter, and it's not been very good for the majors or the juniors, because everybody takes their cue from what is the metal price trend. However, lithium carbonate spot prices, which shot from a low of $5 a pound in 2020 to a high of about $35 a pound this year, has only fallen back into the $30 to $32 per pound range, where it seems to be stuck and is not going back to where people think it should be. People like Elon Musk, they would like it to be cheaper. And in terms of the electric vehicle adoption on a mass scale, $30-$35 a pound lithium carbonate seems to be a little high to make the cars affordable for the masses. And lithium's going to be part of the future battery, even if it's the lithium iron phosphate battery, which is not a very good battery. It's sort of a lower end battery with shorter driving ranges, lower cost, not the sort of thing that people who want an electric vehicle that's very efficient are going to want. It's a popular battery in China, where it's all about getting around relatively short distances. And where basically the government has mandated that we are shifting from gasoline-powered vehicles to electric vehicles because we have this horrible dependency on oil imports. If we ever get into a fight with the United States, that's going to be a problem getting the oil to our country. So we're shifting to electric vehicles because we have to, and even if it requires us to burn coal in order to make the electricity, so it's more for a strategic reason. But I think lithium mania is going to get legs this fall, because on Thursday, the California Air Resources Board passed a rule that says that by 2035, all new cars have to be free of any sort of fossil fuel emissions. That means electric vehicles of some sort, no more internal combustion engine cars. And they would like it to be 35% of all cars sold by 2026, which is only 3-4 years down the road, and 68% by 2030. And California has a GDP and population bigger than Canada. And the rules it sets with fuel efficiency standards, there's about a dozen states that typically follow it. So this rule, if it isn't shot down by a lawsuit that 17 Republican attorney generals from Republican states have filed to block this, for some reason they are obsessed with preventing electric vehicles and the energy transition from happening. There's a strange obsession with fossil fuels forever type of thing. If they are unable to block this is going to really put everybody's attention on the fact that there just isn't enough lithium supply for all these electric vehicles to run on a lithium ion based battery by 2030, by 2035. And in fact, Rio Tinto has projected that by 2035-40, the world will need 10 times as much lithium output as there was last year, which was about 100,000 tons of lithium metal. That is a staggering number. At the current $30 a pound price, that would represent a million tons of lithium metal. That would be like a $300-400 billion a year market, as big as aluminum. But even if you drop it back to $10 a pound, that's still a $100 billion market, going up from about $8 billion last year. So this is an incredible growth area, and that's the reason why, I've picked up on this idea of lithium mania 2.0. The very first start was about 2010, 2012, which coincided with the rare earth mania 1.0. That's when Tesla went public, and there were lots of plug-in hybrids starting to emerge. The mania 1.0 that resulted in a number of buyouts rather than bankruptcies, that took place between 2015 and 2017. And that's when all the talk about electric vehicles really started to ramp up, and the car companies started following Tesla's lead. Tesla really started selling cars. And what happened there, the reason it ended, was the Australians were so efficient at mobilizing new mine supply groups like Pilbara Minerals putting their pegmatite deposits into production, that their output overshot the emerging lithium-ion battery demand, and the price collapsed from $10 to $15 a pound lithium carbonate all the way down to $2.50 to $3 a pound, where it was sort of stuck in early 2020. And that's why the whole sort of lithium mania 1.0 fell apart. But that changed at the start of 2021 when the United States gained a presidency that actually wants to do something about human-caused climate change, and when it became clear that the car industry had completely ignored efforts to help them out by lowering fuel efficiency standards and doing everything possible to pump fossil fuel usage, it turned out the car sector globally and within America completely ignored it and ramped up their electric vehicle plans to a point of no return. They are not coming back. So this California move, which if it isn't blocked, will really justify or legitimize what the car companies are already doing on their own. And I think we're going to see we now have the imbalance in the opposite direction, where there isn't enough lithium for all the electric vehicles that are being made. But a lot more needs to be made. The Australians and the companies in the lithium triangle of South America, they will all be mobilizing more supply over the next few years. But the really hard question is, what about the other 500,000 tons of lithium metal needed annually by 2035? Where's that supposed to come from? China supposedly is going to mobilize new supply from its brine and lepidolite deposits. There's skepticism that the lepidolite can be an effective source of lithium for their needs. But that's a domestic thing for China. They're probably not going to be exporting any of this. But Eastern Canada, which has an incredible endowment of pegmatites that have only been cursorily explored, they would find them, they'd document them, but they would never do anything with it because lithium was such a small market for such a long time, dominated by the brine producers in Chile and a few bedrock mines like Greenbushes in Australia. But all these deposits out there, they're now getting a fresh look. And we've seen the example of Patriot Battery Metals. This was a little company called 92 Resources Corp, which, back in 2017 when Midland made its Mithril copper discovery, and we thought there was a new type of copper deposit in the James Bay region. They had, as part of Lithium Mania 1.0, optioned the Corvette project, which when lithium ended up collapsing down to $3 a pound, this was absolutely worthless, but they ended up doing several rollbacks, reorganizing themselves, wiping out existing shareholders with an equivalent of a 30-for-1, repositioned and started drilling this year on the Corvette, and they're coming up with broad intervals of 1.5%. They've recently put out results for a new zone to the west, which has higher intervals, grade intervals in the 2 to 3% range. And the stock now has a $700 million valuation. They recently attracted as a chairman the former managing director of Pilbara Minerals. So this company is now attracting a serious board. It's no longer this little lithium boom tailgating. They have a substantial 50-kilometer trend that's quite unexplored. It is in the sort of northern part of the James Bay region, relatively remote. But what we're seeing with the attitude in Quebec and in Ontario, the provincial governments, they're looking at the criticality issue for us, these minerals. The feds have created a special 30% flow-through tax. The recent Inflation Reduction Act that the United States passed, $370 billion, that requires companies to source their critical inputs for their electric vehicles and other energy transition technologies, either in the United States or allies. It's questionable who counts as an ally. Mexico has just nationalized its lithium sector, and meanwhile they're busy doing everything they can to block the energy transition and instead pumping state-controlled fossil fuel and energy. So Canada is the obvious place to develop these critical metal supplies, in particular lithium. So eastern Canada is going to have a boom bigger than the diamond boom in the 90s when diamonds were found in the slave craton, with a $700 million market cap. The upside is not huge. The governments will support the bringing the infrastructure in, the transportation infrastructure in to these areas. And of course, the key part is the lithium hydroxide refineries. You create these spodumene concentrates, but then they still have to be converted. Right now, most of that conversion takes place in China. And with this escalating conflict between China and United States over autocracy versus democracy, with China already destroying Hong Kong as a democracy, and with its eyes on destroying Taiwan as a democracy, this is going to result in probably a serious supply problem. Rare earths are going to be a huge problem for the United States, which is also a good thing for Canada, who has not really made too great an effort to explore and exploit its rare earth resources. But it's the processing capacity, not just what China produces, but for all these metals and minerals that go to China for processing. This processing capacity has to shift. And in the case of lithium, we are seeing the Canadian government's supportive of it, and we are going to see this massive exploration boom in eastern Canada, Ontario, Quebec, Atlantic Canada, where we're seeing pegmatites being explored in Nova Scotia, New Brunswick, and Newfoundland. And the company, the bottom fish that I've introduced to my readers as my favorite exploration junior, is Bob Ware's Brunswick Exploration. It has been picking up land packages all over the place. Bob, who was late to the game, only sort of started getting interested middle of last year. He's absolutely stunned that his competitors haven't gone out there and figured out where these regions are that are likely to host lithium-enriched pegmatites and stake the land. Instead, they've put little postage stamps on known showings. He's out there looking at this stuff with his NITOM gun, taking readings of rubidium, which is the key pathfinder that you can see in a pegmatite that tells you that it is likely enriched in lithium. So this company, compared to the $700 million market cap of Patriot Battery, it has a $50 million market cap. Its projects, while it has some up in the James Bay area, its projects tend to be closer to infrastructure, and we'll be starting to see results flow in the next few weeks from their field work. They go out there, they peel back the moss, they shoot the pegmatite, and if it clicks, they collect samples. They'll be getting these grab sample assays, setting the stage for drilling multiple targets, possibly some even in the fourth quarter of this year, but definitely next year. They'll have a whole inventory of these pegmatite targets that they've developed from scratch. And some of them, they were even able to use Google Earth to see the white traces, suggesting, aha, here's a pegmatite, part of which is outcropping. So Patriot Battery Metals attracting big league Australians who are familiar with the pegmatite game, who recognize the scale, money coming in, driving up this to a $700 million plus valuation. And then other ones, you can fairly quickly drill off these pegmatites. They are not these complex structures such as the high-grade uranium deposits in the Athabasca Basin, as I was mentioning earlier with Canalaska and its New West MacArthur discovery, where you have 2,500 to $3,500 rock and relatively small zones. And the stunning thing about these lithium lithium deposits. I've created in my website a lithium rock value matrix where you can look at the different grades and see what the rock value is for the different grades at the different metal, different lithium carbonate prices. For example, for Patriot battery, there are 1.5% lithium oxide intervals. That's almost $2,500 rock. And if you double that to 3%, we're talking about $4,900 rock. And if we see the lithium carbonate price, you know, fall back to $10 per pound, normally that makes everybody despair and say, oh, the mania, the bubble is over. Well, at 1.5%, we're still dealing with $818 rock. And at 3%, $1,600 rock. It's when you start getting down to $2 or $3 where you have, you know, even though it's $160 to $300 rock, the high cost of hydrometallurgy, of, you know, refining it and all that, that makes those deposits marginal at that price, which is why when the lithium carbonate price collapsed to that level in 2017-18, all these pegmatite plays were dead in the water. But now they are alive and well. The rock value is really high. And if, like Patriot Battery, you can start stitching together these deposits with drilling to just delineating them quickly, you can have your resource estimate in fairly quick time. Then you have to do, you know, your purity analysis, make sure there's not too much iron and other baddies in there that are going to make the refiners not want to take your concentrate. But there are so many such deposits all over Canada that the solution to the supply problem, which you know, California is helping create by mandating zero internal combustion engine car sales by 2035, that solution is staring us in our face in eastern Canada. And the next 3 years are going to be a phenomenal period of excitement where even like ragged little juniors who don't quite know what to do but have managed to stake some land and realize that, oh, this has lithium potential, get some competent people in there, start drilling it off, they too might have a 10, 20 million ton deposit of 1.5, 1 to 2% lithium oxide that could become part of the mill feed that Canada sets up to process the concentrates and supply the rest of the world for the missing half of the million tons of lithium metal that Rio Tinto thinks the world will need by 2035, if indeed electric vehicles based on a lithium-ion battery are going to replace the internal combustion engine. And this doesn't even take into consideration the possibility that a solid-state electrolyte is invented, which allows lithium metal to substitute for graphite in the anode, which would make a super battery that is also safe, and that would increase the demand even greater. We don't have that breakthrough yet, but it's the holy grail of a lot of R&D to try and make this happen, because this getting the making these cars efficient and cheap, that's the key to having mass adoption of electric vehicles.
John, thank you so much for the update.
You're welcome, Jim.
We've been talking with John Kaiser. I'm Jim Goddard. Comments made on Kaiser Watch are an expression of opinion only and should not be construed in any manner whatsoever as a recommendation to buy or sell any financial instrument at any time. Archived online at kaiserresearch.com.